together. The church is better together. Across boundaries and borders, beyond walls and notions, we're part of something far more powerful, far more potent than any of us could ever fully imagine or dream. A mission far bigger than any of us could ever accomplish on our own. We exist to make Jesus known. And in that pursuit, we become the best version of who God created us to be. A reflection of His love, His truth, His grace, His hands, His feet. One in mission, one in heart, one in love for Jesus and people. Arms locked to serve, give, and show the world His love, which has no equal. And when we do, God goes before us. Hope rises. People turn their feet to Jesus. Families grow stronger. Communities come together. Lives forever change for the better. Victory is won. This is church. This is together. This is who we are. It's what we were made for. And all the glory goes to the one who makes it all possible. Jesus. To His name be all the glory, honor, and praise. Welcome to the movement, 2,000 years in the making. Welcome to church.
Hey everybody, what's up? How you doing? Are you ready for some church? I'm ready for some church right outside the mountains of North Carolina, waiting on a couple people to arrive here for our little gathering, checking in from just outside of Asheville. Where are you guys checking in from today? Let us know in the chat. Share up the service right now and then type shared in the chat so we can get the word out. We're in week number 4 of our series on the overflow perspective, having that different lens, looking at life, and today is all about thankfulness and generosity. What good timing, right? Thanksgiving weekend, Turkey Day's over, Black Friday's over, and we've got Giving Tuesday coming up just around the corner. More on that from Pastor Jason here in just a little bit. But we're just glad you're here. Check in with us. Get in the Bible plan. Generosity as freedom. You're going to want to get Bible engaged with us as a community. We think the Bible is better read together in community. So why don't you join us? Give it a try. Have a great time today, guys. Again, any questions, leave them in the chat. We're just glad you're here.
Well, hey, everyone. Thank you so much, Church We Are, for joining us. We are so glad that you're here. We just pray as we sing these songs, as we lift our praises up to Jesus, that He would visit you wherever you're at, whether you're in the car, whether you're at home, or you're in a coffee shop, that Jesus would become Emmanuel right now, and His presence would fill that place wherever you're at. And I just pray that you would just be blessed. So as you hear these songs, I just pray that you would focus on Him and sing to Him, and that He would visit you and your family today. Thank you so much for worshiping with us. Let's do this together.
He told me that I was not alone. that we have to worship. And thank you for worshiping with us today.
There's just something incredibly special about this moment that I love to savor every weekend. Just take a second and think about this, that right now together, even though we're in different spaces, in different living rooms and different homes and coffee shops, and again, even those around campfires and all the different places that people take in church where you are, but yet as we sing, we're lifting up the name of Jesus with one voice. I don't know about you, but that just inspires me every single week to think about that. It's great perspective to remember that we're giving praise to our God together at this gathering. We're lifting up the name of Jesus together. And Jesus said, wherever two or three are gathered in my name, I will be there. I'm thankful today that Jesus is here. And I'm thankful today that you are here worshiping with us. And we're going to continue that worship time now through a time of giving. And maybe you've heard us talk about it over the past few weeks, but we're leading up to a big day here on November the 29th. Giving Tuesday is coming. And each week we've been talking to you about one of the initiatives that we're participating in for this Giving Tuesday. You know, we said Giving Tuesday is a national movement. It's the Tuesday after Black Friday. And really, it started in 2012 with just a heart of generosity. You know, it's just such a time of year where we start thinking about what we're getting. How different would it be, or what kind of a difference could we make if we just thought about giving during this season? And so I've got a video today for you to check out with our international spotlight. Remember, locally we're doing our part to enhance student and kids spaces at church locations, physical locations. Regionally, we're doing our part to plant churches, more churches in homes, and again, physical locations. We're looking in that region right there in southern Michigan. And then now, internationally, you're going to hear a little bit about what we're dreaming about doing, what we're believing God for doing in 2023 internationally through our efforts in the Dominican Republic. I'll let Pastor Nate tell you more about it.
Hey everybody, this is Pastor Nate here, and I am so excited to talk to you today about our Giving Tuesday opening up on November 29th. We as a church, our Giving Tuesday aim is to reach more people and do more good in the name of Jesus in 2023. And that's through local and regional and international initiatives. So today I get the opportunity to talk to you about our international focus for 2023. Our goal is to double our mission efforts in the Dominican Republic in 2023. That's by building homes, it's by building futures, it's by building life-changing stories. It's through supporting the missions work of Great Commission Latin America. That's our heart for the work that we have been doing in the Dominican Republic in the years past, and a goal for the years to come. We want to send more teams to build more homes for families who are in need. We want the opportunity to support more children and build better futures through the Child Development Institute efforts. And we also want to be an opportunity to strengthen the local church, the Great Commission Church there, for many years to come. So our focus, number one, is to support the mission work in the area with Great Commission Latin America by doubling the amount of teams that we send in 2023. The second thing is we want to support the Child Development Institute efforts through technology resourcing. And the third thing is we want to build four homes for families in need. So internationally, in 2023, our dream, our desire is to see the church in Santo Domingo thrive. It's to see families to be safe and healthy in these new homes. It's for children to grow exponentially through their education, and most importantly, the gospel of Jesus Christ to be shared and received in the streets of Santo Domingo and Nagua. We move at the speed of God's leading through the generosity of God's people. So if this Giving Tuesday stirs you up, this initiative stirs you up, and you are looking for a way to invest your year-end tax-deductible gift, we would love the opportunity to do this together with you in 2023. locally by enhancing our campus spaces regionally through planting new churches, and internationally by doubling our efforts in the Dominican Republic. So, giving opens up for all our Giving Tuesday initiatives on November 29th. And it's gonna stay open through the end of the year. As always, we can't tell you enough how much we appreciate your generosity towards what God is doing. God bless everybody. We'll see you.
It's always an amazing reminder. And I hope it's an encouragement to you to know that that's the difference that your giving is making here at church where you are. That, what you just saw, it only happens because people like you so faithfully support the mission, and we get to do this together. So I just want to say thank you so much to all of you that are on mission with us on this journey to reach more people and do more good in 2023. It really does mean the world to me, and I know it means so much more to Jesus. You can give today primarily in one way. Just use your mobile device right now and text an amount to 84321. Again, just simply use your mobile device right now and send a text with an amount to 84321. If it's your first time giving via text, there's a little bit of setup required, but you have to choose church where you are as your church. But after that first initial gift, giving each week will be as easy as sending a text. Let's pray today over this Giving Tuesday, over this giving today, that God would bless it, use it, make Jesus known through this generosity today. And let's pray just for this Giving Tuesday coming on November the 29th, that God would do what only He can and incredible things would happen in the year ahead. Will you pray with me? God, we are so thankful for the opportunity to give today. We're thankful for the fact that you've blessed our lives, all the ways that you've provided for us, watched over us, God, taken care of us. God, we don't take one piece of that for granted today. We're so thankful. So today we return our gifts back to you with glad and sincere hearts, thanking you for all the ways that you love us and care for us and watch over our lives. God, our prayer today is that you would bless this giving, that you would use it in a mighty way, make Jesus known through this today. And God, we pray for Giving Tuesday and the year ahead, 2023. We pray for incredible things that can be done only through you. But God, I pray that you would bless the life today of every giver for the blessing that they are to the life of another week in and week out. I know it means so much to you, God. So I pray today that you would just encourage them today in their giving and in their generosity. All the glory goes to you today, Jesus. We love you. We thank you again for this opportunity. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, and everybody said, amen.
Perspective. Well, it's everything. It directs us. It brings focus to our lives. We all want to experience what's best for us. So maybe the first step towards experiencing God's best in my life is to ask the question, what is my perspective?
Well, hey everyone, welcome to church where you are. My name is Nate and I'm a pastor around here, and it is so awesome to know that you are choosing to make the decision today to do church right where you may be. And I have no clue where that is, but I'm so excited that you would do that. In fact, just let us know, where are you choosing to do church where you are? Where is that? And you may be going, well, that's great, Nate. You go ahead and ask me. Go ahead, ask me where I am, but where are you? Well, I'm in beautiful Angola, Indiana. That's where I live. And I'm so excited that I get to do this with you today, to do church with you, no matter where you are. Whether you're scattered across the country or maybe even a different country, but you choose to be with us today, and that is incredible. Well done. We're so glad that you would be with us as we're wrapping up this series called The Overflow Perspective. Man, this series has been challenging to me. I don't know how it has been for you, but it's just amazing to think about the fact that in our world, it's so important for us to understand what our perspective is of this world. It's everything. It really comes down to it is everything. It directs us in so many different ways. And throughout this series, we've talked about the idea that we have, really, there's like three different perspectives that we can have in this world. One of them could be just the overwhelmed perspective. It's the everyday life where we're striving to get to a certain place in this world, that we'd meet a certain standard. And when we finally get to that certain standard, we would have it all together. But the truth of the matter is it's never enough. We can never get there. And so what ends up happening is we find ourselves overwhelmed more than anything else. Our perspective of the world is just a completely overwhelmed perspective. Another perspective that we have is a completely unaware perspective, which means that we're just completely ignorant to the fact that we should have a perspective of the world, that we should see the world in a certain way. And ultimately, it just leads us eventually to an overwhelmed perspective, because that's where the world leads us. But the goal would be that through this series, that we would maybe grab a hold of the fact that there is a different perspective for our life, one that is, it's life-changing for us. It's not an outward experiences or circumstances coming in on us, but an internal change pouring out of us in an overflow perspective. And so throughout this series, throughout week one, we found out that it really starts that there's people that see this, that know this, that understand this. There's something different about them, the way they see the world around them, their possessions, their relationships, and just the circumstances of the world around them. They just see it differently. They respond to it differently. And they just know something that maybe we don't know. And so we talked about in week one, what they know is who they are. I don't know who they are and who they belong to understand that they are Jesus's, that they belong to Jesus, and that they are heirs to a kingdom that is not going anywhere. In week two, we talked about the fact that they understand these people know with an overflow perspective. They know that Jesus calls mankind into a full and abundant life. And it's so amazing to be able to experience it, but it comes at a cost, that there's things in their life that are obstacles that keeps them from living that out. But to get past those obstacles, to move those obstacles out of the way, as difficult as it may be, it is totally worth it. And the last week we talked about the fact that what they know, those with an overflow perspective, they understand that no matter how hard they need to work to meet the standards that maybe the world is offering, it's never going to be enough. And that ultimately our security can rely on the fact that knowing that it all belongs to God anyways. He's the one that created all. He's the one that it belongs to. And the more that we understand that all that I have belongs to Jesus, the easier it is for me to be generous with it, be generous with my life, be generous with my kindness, be generous with my joy. Which brings us to this week, this final week, of beginning to understand what those with an overflow perspective understand. As this week we're beginning to, we want to dig into the fact that what individuals with this overflow perspective know, and what we should know, is what the why behind what God has done in their lives, and why God would mark it out this way. Let's see, the title of this message today is, So They Will Know. Knowing the why makes all the difference in the world. Knowing the purpose, knowing a purpose for something makes all the difference in the world. It actually changes the way we see things. You know what I mean, though. You've probably seen these before. Maybe you've seen the videos or the memes of those products that have been put out there that are the everyday products that we have that actually have other purposes to them beyond what we understand. You know, you've seen it, like the spaghetti scooper thing, right? Well, there's a picture of it right here. Like, you know what I'm saying? These spaghetti scoopers. But then we always ever wondered, what's that hole in there for? Well, it's probably for drainage. No. In fact, it's there for us to help understand us what the serving size is. Blows your mind when you first saw that, I'm sure. How about this? Our soda cans, right? Our soda pop cans. When we have the tab that opens it up, right? Makes sense. Ever wondered why it's the shape the way it is? Well, you turn it around, it's there for your straw. What? There's so many different items that we begin to see. You've probably seen these things. And we're like, holy smokes, I didn't realize that was what that was for. But it changes the way you see it, though, doesn't it? When you begin to see it in a different way, boy, that really helps us to understand, man, there's something bigger to all of this. And this is no different for us as people. In fact, internally, like, this is something that we all desire to know. We want to know that there is something more, that purpose, there's a why. In fact, there's a study that's out there. And this study says that 4 in 5 Americans, 81% of Americans, believe that there is an ultimate purpose and plan in every person's life. That more than 2 in 3 Americans, 68%, say a major priority in their life is finding their deeper purpose. And 73% of these Americans say it's important that they pursue a higher purpose and meaning for their life. There's something guttural within us. There's something that causes us, that wants us to understand this, that beginning to understand that maybe we'll change our perspective in the world, understanding that all that God has done, all that he has planned, everything that he has put into motion has a purpose, that us, as creation, being created by God, we have been created for something more than what the world is showing us, than what we understand. That if we could grab a hold of that, if we could begin to understand what that purpose is, it will change the way we see things. It'll change the way that we see the world around us. It'll change the way that we see our careers. It'll change the way we see ourselves. It changes the way we see the people around us. It will change so many things if we could begin to understand what our purpose is. And the beauty of who God is that each and every one of us, we have specific purposes in our life, but we also have an overall purpose as a people. That God's desire for each and every one of us is to understand something. And in fact, Paul, he wrote a letter to the Romans, and in that letter he wrote to them and shared what I believe is really what God's desire is for us. And he's speaking to the Roman people about a specific type of people who just maybe don't understand completely what the purpose is, what their purpose is, what God is trying to do, what Jesus was brought here to do. And he's writing to the Romans about the Hebrew nation. He writes this in chapter 10. It says this: "Brothers, my heart's desire and prayer to God is for the Israelites. For the Israelites is that they may be saved. For I can testify about them that they are zealous for God, but their zeal is not based on knowledge, since they did not know the righteousness that comes from God and sought to establish their own. They did not submit to God's righteousness. Christ is the end of the law, so that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes." You see, Paul's talking about a specific people, the Israelite nation, who have an idea of what this is supposed to look like. But what he's saying is, like, they don't actually know. They're a nation who believes that they are right, that they completely understand what it is, that they have all these things established in order, in place, so that they may be good enough to experience the Messiah's return. And what he's saying is that they don't. They just don't know. That I want more for them. That, in fact, the purpose is so that they would know more. But they're settled into this belief that if I'm just good enough. And we live in a world that's very much like that. We live in a world that believes that they are right, no matter who they are. Everyone believes that they know exactly what they're talking about. Whether it's be a company who's pushing a product, their product is the right product, it's the actual product that you need. Whether it is a religious group who believes this is the right belief, this is one of the right thing to think. Whether it be a political party, my way is the right way. Just people in general always believe that they're settled into the fact that they are right. But what if they're not? What if their belief and what they're pursuing after isn't right? Well, that's unsettling, isn't it? Well, see, what Paul is expressing to the Roman people, and really what God is trying to tell us, is that there's a whole group of people who just have no clue. That we live in the middle of a world that has no idea what really the purpose is for them, what our purpose is for them, so they may know. And so when Paul continues on in Romans 10, he goes into verse 9, it says this. He says, "If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As Scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. What Paul is saying is it comes down to this, regardless of who people are, regardless of where they come from, regardless of their background, it all comes down to this piece right here, that Jesus is Lord. That if we would believe, that if people would believe, confess with their mouth and believe in their heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, that they may be saved. And that there's so much more for their life and understanding, that their perspective in life will completely change. And he continues to go on, speaking directly to those Romans and speaking directly to us in verse 14 when he says this, how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? So basically what it's coming down to is Paul is saying everything that has been done, everything God has done, creation, direction, salvation, all that he has done with people and moving them forward and moving the timeline forward, everything with Jesus and the Holy Spirit has been for the very specific purpose of all mankind knowing that he is God, that he's the creator, that he wants to be known by all. Why? So that they may realize their purpose in this life. And Paul, he's stating it to the Romans, and I believe God is directing this towards us as well, is that our purpose, what's going on in our life, the reason that we would want to have an overflow perspective in this life is so that people would be drawn to us and go, whoa, why are you the way you are? So that they may know God. So that we can say it's only by him. It's all that he's done internally within me. That he's established a foundation. That there's a kingdom that I'm inheriting. That is unshakable. That's not going anywhere. That everything that he has done, all that he has put into motion, has been so the simple fact that all may know him. And by knowing him, they'll realize that their purpose, their talents, their time, their treasures, their identity, everything that people have grown and learned from God and what he's changed within them is so that they may know him, so that they may be saved. God is a patient God, a gracious God who desires for all mankind to know him, to be saved. So we hear that. Okay, so we understand, and maybe there's some purpose. I got some purpose in my life. There's things that God is doing. There's a reason that he's done all that he has done in my life so that people may know him. But how do I do that? How do I, Nate, in Angola, Indiana, do that for others? How do I live in such a way that people may see God and know who God is? Well, I think the first thing that we need to know, and the first thing that we need to do really is to, you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. He also says, you are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Jesus is specifically saying to people, listen, there has been a good work that has taken place in you. You have been changed. You are a salt. You are a preservative to this world. You are one that brings flavor to this world. Don't lose that saltiness. Don't hide it. Let it pour out of you. He says, you're a light in the world. You can't. And a light that is a light in a world that is dark, like you cannot hide it. Don't put it under a bowl. Let people see it. Don't keep it to yourself. Why? Why? So they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. That when we would choose to make a decision to care about the others, to be kind, to be inquisitive, to be hospitable, to be who he's called us to be, ultimately will cause people to see that he is who he says he is, no matter where you are. Now, recently we just did we went on a missions trip to the Dominican Republic and got the great opportunity to share some stories, to hear some stories, to interview some people. And I want to share a story with you here. It's a video of an interview that we had with a woman in the Dominican Republic and living in Nagua. Her name's Samaya. And Samaya is special. She really is. See, Samaya lives in this community that there's very little. People are living in, if you could call it a shed, that would be glorifying what it really is. But there's nothing much to it. And Samaya has been impacted by the Great Commission of Latin America, who's the church down there that we support, that we go down and work with, in building homes there, and tearing down old homes and building new homes, new stable homes, safe and secure homes. And Samaya is someone who lives in that community, has seen the impact of what's taken place. And so let me share this story with you. Watch this.
Mi nombre es Patria Pérez, me dicen Samay. Bueno, les doy gracias a Dios por haberlo traído aquí a mi comunidad, mi sector Puerta Blanca, donde habitamos dentro de las personas con enfermedad de lepra, que fue la causa que lo trajo aquí a conocer a esa persona. Dios tuvo el control. Me decía Melfra la primera vez que vino que cómo llegaba aquí, porque Nigua no se encuentra en el mapa. Fue preguntando hasta que llegaron a Nigua. ¿Por qué digo que le damos gracias a Dios? Porque a través de ustedes, muchos de nuestros pacientes que están fuera del centro hoy viven dignamente. Que son pacientes de que la persona lo abandonaron. Y por ayuda de la monja, que le suplen sus medicamentos, comida, pero no tienen tantas cosas para poderlo poner a vivir dignamente como ustedes. ¿Cómo no darle gracias a Dios todos los días de que ustedes estén hoy en mi comunidad? Porque no solamente a los pacientes, sino a muchos niños que también no vivían dignamente a través de ustedes. Hoy tienen un hogar, tienen una cama donde dormir, tienen una familia que por lo menos cuando llueve no se moja. Solamente Dios que toca corazones a ustedes. Ustedes fueron que pudieron tener a esa persona hoy que pueden decir, sí, Dios, gracias a esa iglesia, Gran Comisión, a esos hermanos que se desprenden hasta de llevarse un pan para dárselo a otro. Hoy podemos dormir, hoy podemos comer. Si viene un ciclón, no tenemos que salir corriendo. Solamente ustedes pudieron hacer eso. ¿Por qué? Porque lo digo por Severa, que fue la primera paciente que ustedes le pudieron arreglar la casa. Juanín, que Dios ya la llamó, dos hermanas ciegas rotundamente, hoy tienen un techo. Tienen un techo, Juanín. Su último tiempo en esta tierra, pudo decir, tuvo una casa, porque ustedes, con la gracia de Dios, se hicieron. Ahí está Felipe. Que sé que cuando llegamos a la casa de Felipe, Felipe vivía entre tumbas. Y hoy Felipe puede decir, duermo en una casa, no duermo en una tierra, como lo encontramos esa vez. Ahí también tenemos las niñas, María, las hermanitas, muchachitas que nacieron con deformación en la vista. También dormían encima de una mata, prácticamente una mata dentro de la casa. Hoy tienen un hogar. Tienen un hogar porque ustedes se lo dieron. También tenemos a Blanquita, Ustedes saben, tú que lo viviste, que viví entre patos, porque no tenía un hogar, también hoy tiene un hogar. También tenemos a Mayreli, que ustedes saben que fue algo impactante cuando llovía, que el agua entraba por un lado y salía por otro. Hoy Mayreli y su hermanita tienen una casa, tienen un hogar que prácticamente mi hermana no podía sostenerla porque no teníamos la condición de hacerle esa casa. Otra persona de allá arriba, doña Marcia, que también era una chorrera, hoy tiene un hogar. ¿Cómo no darle gracias a Dios? ¿Cómo no darse? Si Dios lo trajo a usted de aquí a traer bendiciones y siguen dando bendiciones. Porque mira a César, mira al hermano de Polo, mira ahora a Marcia, mira a la persona que se le quemaron la casa. Yo siempre digo que los hijos, nosotros los hijos de Dios, no mendigamos pan, porque Dios siempre no tiene el pan ahí, no tiene el día a día. Y yo creo que si nos alejamos de Él, entonces no vamos a ver la grandeza de Él. Pero si seguimos forzando, seguimos arrodillándonos, pidiéndole con fe, ¿qué cosa Dios no nos dará a nosotros? Entonces, nada, mil gracias. No me voy a cansar de darle la gracia primero a Dios y después a ustedes. Porque verdaderamente ver a Yajaira, ver a Blanquita, ver a Pedro, ver todas esas personas que hoy podemos decir, sí, Dios, lo logramos. Lo logramos por ti, porque sin ti no somos nada.
How amazing is that? Samaya has watched God work in the midst of all this, and all she can do is attribute it to God and God's people. To seeing the people who are coming along through there love Jesus, love God, and they love others. And their work, the deeds, have led them to see that it is not anything that man is really doing. It is all due to God. And she just continuously gives glory to God. And you want to know what's amazing about Samaya and this woman? Is that she doesn't have one of those homes that we've built. She lives in a shack. And she chooses, she helps others. She helps establish others to be able to get their home. That's a part of what she does in that city. It's incredible to see what God is willing to do, that it will impact and ripple throughout the world. And so when we think about that, well, that's a long way to go. I don't know if I could ever make it to the Dominican Republic to help that and to show my light and to let the overflow spill out into others. And so what do I do? Well, I'd say you have to start somewhere. And you need to start with your splash zone. Start with my splash zone. You ever been to SeaWorld or something like it? Maybe a little bit sketchy to talk about that right now, but SeaWorld had a splash zone. It was first several rows and in next to the pool where the orcas would come through and splash all over those that were right there near them, getting them all wet. The water would overflow out to those that were near. And so that's what I would say. Is start with who's near to you. You start with your family. My word, start right there in your own home. Start with your neighbors that are really right next to you. Start letting your overflow pour out onto them and watch what takes place. Because here's the truth of the matter. The world cannot be impacted if our neighborhoods are missed. The world cannot be impacted if our homes are left with emptiness. If our dinner tables are being missed with the overflow, it has to start around us. And then when we start to join in with one another, when we do this as a church, when we begin to have impact and spill out in the world around us, we will see the ripple effect take place, that it will spread out, that we would join churches all over our nation, all over our world, to see the gospel of Jesus go forward, to see so that people can see our good deeds, which is only coming from the overflow of what God has done internally through us, that people would see His goodness, they would know His faithfulness, and they would choose to glorify Him, our Father in heaven. That is what it's all about. I want you to listen to this scripture in Mark. Mark 12, 30-31 says this: love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. There is no commandment greater than these to love God with all that we have and love our neighbors and love one another. And this is what it's all about, so that people may know him, may see our good deeds, and glorify our Father in heaven. Why is it important to have an overflow perspective? So that people may know him. Not just impacting us, but impacting those around us. Listen, if we all, each and every one of us, no matter where we are, spread out across this nation into other countries, if we would choose to allow God to work within us and allow a change to take place within us that pours out of us, that we wouldn't allow the world's circumstances to come in on us, but we would allow God to work through us and his goodness pour out of us, we would see the world impacted if we just start right where we are. Then we would go and we would begin to see it spread. That we would choose to do what God is offering, the opportunities that he's offering for us. Does it mean that you don't go on missions trips? No, all the more so. But make sure we're starting right where we are, in our homes, in our neighborhoods, in our communities, in our churches, and watch God do something through that that we can't do on our own. This is what we get to do. So I pray that you would join me and others in choosing to see the world differently, allowing God to change our perspective, to allow Jesus be the one that leads us, that regardless that we wouldn't strive for all the world has to offer, but we would offer ourselves and all that we have for God to do work through us. And then we would choose to let this all be seen, to see, let our good deeds be seen by man so that they may glorify our Father in heaven. This is what we get to do. Let me pray for you. Father, we thank you for who you are. Lord, we thank you for the direction that you've offered for each and every one of us. Lord, we thank you that you see us for something more than we could ever see ourselves. Lord, we thank you for the purpose that you've given each and every one of us in our life, the very specific individual purposes, Lord, and just the overall purpose, which is to let our good deeds, because of what you've done in our life, the overflow that's coming out of us, let those be seen so man may glorify our Father in heaven. They may glorify you. And so, Father, we just thank you for the opportunity today just to honor you with ourselves, with our whole being. Lord, that we would choose to today just to intentionally choose to take the perspective of the overflow into our lives. That we would see that you are the center of it, that you are the goodness in this world, that there is no goodness in us. It's all because of you and what you have done and what you're trying to do in each and every one of us. So Lord, I pray that our kindness would spill out into the world around us. That Lord, that we would allow the overflow to pour out and to spill out all over into a splash zone around us. Lord, allow that to change others because of who you are. And so Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity today just to do just that. And so Lord, we just thank you that regardless of where we've been, regardless of what we've done, your desire is that you want to see people come to know you so that you may develop a relationship with them so that they may see their purpose. And today, you may be watching this and realizing that you don't know your purpose, that you really don't know what to do with your life, and that you're ready to make a decision for that to change. And maybe this perspective that you've had, maybe you've been living with this overwhelmed perspective in your life. where you've been completely unaware, but you are ready to, you want that to change. You want to see things differently. Well, I want to tell you that today it only happens through, it happens through the name of Jesus. It happens through Him. He's the one that leads the way. He is the gate. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And so today we just want to offer you that opportunity to say yes to Him. And you may not know, completely know what that even means or how that even, what that even looks like in your life. And that's okay. That's why we're here. That's why we're doing what we're doing. So that you may know Him and that you may begin to realize your purpose. And so we want to join you in that. And so if you're feeling that stirring happening around you, we just simply grab your phone and send turn my feet to 94000 so we can help you on that journey, that we can help you along the way. That's why we're here. That's what this is all about. So text turn my feet, turnmyfeet, to 94000. Let me continue to pray for you. Father, we thank you for those that are making that decision. Lord, we thank you for what you're going to do through each and every one of us. So Lord, we give you the glory. We give you the praise. We thank you for what you are going to do in those that are saying yes to you today. Thank you for the work that you are beginning and the work that you will promise to continue to the very end, to fully completed. So Lord, thank you, thank you, thank you for you being you, that we can rely upon you. We love you and we thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, thank you so much for being with us. We can't wait to see you again next week. Come back, be a part of what we're doing, what the Lord is doing through church where you are. Have an amazing week, everybody. God bless.